Well, check it out, y'all. We got what you need. We're all living in apartments, condos, vans. Well, dude, even you can have a studio. A studio in a box. Yes, we can help you with that right here at Blind Knowledge. We work on your budget, and we figure out your measurements. We'll get you the best sound for the best price. Let me know, 877-237-1143, or at blindknowledge.com. Yep!
But belligerent existence gets cast down. Sorry to cut everybody off like that, folks, but like a famous gay man with a mustache once said, the show must go on. Welcome to Maniacal Music Musings. I'm your host, Jeremy, as always. And let me tell you, stuff is messed up. For all the musers we work with, what we got, it's not a choice. Well, I mean, the revolution will be televised by us, thank God. And we will destroy all the monsters the hard way while we do it. My co-host, though. Oh, Bonita, what can I do about you? My favorite bipolar baby with your unbroken borderline personality disorder. Let me sing you the sweetest song as the siren blares. You live on a funk planet, and I always have to ask who's killing who as you're rooting for the bad guys. Chancy Grife, everyone. God help us all.
Hi.
I was proud of that intro, Chancy. I was proud of it. And I wrote in like 2 minutes, so, you know, it works. But,
you know, some children are also proud of their fucking, you know, delinquent failure children. Just saying.
Some children have children? That's what you're telling me? Jesus Christ.
Some parents are proud of their delinquent and failure children. So, like, you know, you're proud of your intro. They're proud of them fucking badass kids. You know, kind of seeing a parallel here. They both kind of suck.
Well,
I liked it. I thought it was great.
Oh, I know. I'm just busting his balls. It's way too early for me to not wait till about later on to bust his balls.
Well, folks, Chancy has retconned his mistake, and we can move on for our broadcast now. We are joined this episode on a very special weekend episode by the return of the German rock star himself, and that's the time I've been marketing you, Phry McDunstan. Welcome back, brother. One of our earlier guests, actually, if I'm not mistaken. It's been a while.
Yeah, it's been exactly a year, I think. So thanks for having me again.
Huh? No fucking way. Really?
Yeah. I mean, my last EP came out 1 year ago, and that's when we first talked. Yeah.
Yeah, man. That's awesome.
Yeah. And I, like, first time Spotify, was great.
Fucking lazy asshole.
I mean, first time was amazing, and I was really looking forward to this all week. And yeah, thanks again for having me.
Of course.
I was stoked. I was stoked when you hit me up and was like, "Hey, man, I got this new EP coming out." And I was like, "Sold the man with gray in his hair."
Chancy buys a lot of things because he has gray in his hair. I don't know why. It's just a bad habit with him. I don't get it. But
I think gray hair is cool. I wish I had gray hair. Like, but it's still there's a couple of them in there, but I would never like dye them if I got them because it just looks so cool. Like,
yeah, I started getting mine at like 16. It kind of sucks, but at the same time, it's like, oh, you know, yeah. But it's like when the gray hair thing came into style,
right?
I was really kind of pissed off about it. It's like, hold on a minute. I've had to deal with this shit for 15 years. Now all of a sudden it's fucking cool.
Yeah, because nowadays, like some teenagers dye their hair like gray. So
yep.
you were way ahead of your time or of the times, man.
Yeah. Family curse.
Well, folks, we brought you albums 3 once again, and we're gonna get started off as always by letting our guest tell us what album he brought and what album do you bring? Because I am excited to talk about it.
Yeah, I brought the Wildhearts self-titled album, or it's sometimes also referred to as the White Album. Because it's fucking white on the cover. And yeah, I mean, the Wildhearts, they're not that very well known. And I've read on their Wikipedia that it's because back in the 90s when they had their first break, they had a lot of trouble going on with their record label and like the lead songwriter, singer, and guitarist Ginger was oftentimes having like struggles with his like mental issues and stuff like that, and depression, which is why they probably never made it to a higher level fame wise. But I think they're one of the greatest rock bands from England from that time, and like their music is amazing. They combine punk rock and hard rock with Metallica song structures, and that really kicks ass. I mean, they once released a compilation titled "Riff After Riff After Motherfucking Riff," and that's what you get when you play some of their records.
Well,
fuck yeah,
Chancy, I gotta go first here because of something he just said that's gonna kind of write what I'm.
No, you're good. You're good. I just had to say fuck yeah because. Dude, that I couldn't have put that better myself. That's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, I have never heard of the Wildhearts until Chancy sent me this album picture, and I'm like, okay, this album's not on Spotify. Fuck me, but okay, I'll listen to it at work on YouTube. It's all good. And I played this album. Holy shit, that's how excited I was. That's how excited I fucking was because. I started listening to like a couple songs to figure out what album I wanted to bring to face it. And it's funny you say Metallica because I'm like, this is like Metallica's guitar playing with Offspring's voice. What the fuck? And I'm like,
yeah.
I mean, okay, there's a certain song where I really heard it, and that's the song I happened to play first. So that's my pick, which we'll get to eventually. But I freaking was. In my head to this shit yesterday at work, like, this is a fucking good band. I'm like, I gotta check out more of their shit. Like, it's just when I first saw it, I'm like, I saw on YouTube they had it's like bonus edition starts after this time point. I'm like, I won't listen to the bonus edition. I don't know how much time I have today. You better believe I fucking listened to the bonus edition because I was fucking I have to hear what else they put out in this shit. I have to. This is a good CD. Like, their guitar and drum work is incredible, and their fucking lyrics are pretty damn good as well. Like, I fucking enjoyed the shit out of it. I never heard of them, and I'm always very skeptical when I never heard of a band and I have to listen to them. I'm just like, oh shit, I've had some bad we've had some guests bring up some albums that are like what, but I gotta say it was very fucking impressive and I enjoyed the fuck out of it. So well done.
I'm glad to hear that. Well done. That's cool. Nice. Thanks. I'm glad to hear that. If you want to, like, they don't always put out albums with the same kind of songs, like these 10-minute progressive rock songs. If you want to listen to another album of theirs that's just like that, listen to Fishing for Luckies. That was the album that introduced me to them. There's also some cool 10-minute riff rock songs on there, which are so cool.
Well, actually, it's funny you say that, because that's actually what a lot of the comments on YouTube said was like, oh, you should go listen to this album, and it was that fucking album. So,
yeah.
And I had some people, there were some people on there like, I don't like this album of theirs. I like this album better. And it's like, okay, good for you. But I enjoyed the fuck out of it. Chancy, what did you think of the Wildhearts?
Dude, I thought it was awesome. Like, for real. I actually listened to it a few times just because it was on YouTube and could play consecutively and just go in, start fucking gaming out, listening to it, and then it was like, oh yeah, I gotta start writing down, like, you know, I got like a honorable mention and shit, but like, oh, I gotta write these down, so I had to do some, you know, multitasking with the Wikipedia and then the thing, and I was like, man, this is fucking awesome. I'm actually having to work, but it's a good album, so it's totally fucking worth it. And you know, Jeremy, you said it was in your head earlier. What's in your head? In your head? Are you a zombie? I understand that joke's gonna crash land because it's way too early. But true Cranberry fans will really enjoy if they ever stumble across this.
I got the joke fucking immediately. I was just like, what kind of Freddie Fisher dad joke is this shit?
Hey, this is the kind of shit. This is the kind of shit that you do, that happens when I wake up early because of my awesome friend Fry, that one over there. And I don't have the ability to warm up the old diesel engine. By about the time the episode's fixing to end, I'm gonna be throwing out zingers. I'm telling you.
Well, you know, folks, just like it's 1940 something, the Germans woke us up early again. But
they didn't wake us up. Man, that's fucked up. That is fucked up.
Like, what time is it where you are now? I don't even know how early it is where you live.
It's almost noon. It's almost noon where I am, and it's almost 11 where Chancy is.
So what the fuck? That's not early.
Like, oh, it is. It is for me. I don't work until 11:30 in the morning. I wake up at 11:20. Oh boy. I work from home, so it's like I just roll out of bed and walk over to my desk, and it's just like.
I mean, so do I, but I get up at 6:30 every morning, and then I work out.
Yeah, I don't do the working out part, okay. But I'll bet you kick ass on fucking guitar and shit. So I mean, there's probably that too.
Yeah, I mean that's a job that's never boring or like
not a job.
No, yeah, it's the best job in the world.
Right.
Well, Fry, what were your top five from your own album? Well, from the album you brought, I should say.
Right. Okay. Like my favorite is Destroy All Monsters, first of all because of the structure. Like, it's that progressive 10-minute thing with a shit ton of riffs in the middle that I really love, and like there's a couple of riffs in the middle that are so wild, like meter wise, and sometimes they do halftime things, and for me as a musician that's just so sweet. And the chorus is killer. The intro, like at first you think, this must be a ballad, but then it really kicks ass with the first chorus when it kicks in. So it's my favorite. Okay. Okay. I'll go through all of them then. Okay.
Oh, yeah,
Number two, Slaughtered Authors, because same thing, progressive rock. And
yes.
Like the chorus is so catchy, and as a musician I can really relate to the lyrics. Like, it's about record labels and also all these fucking talent and casting shows that are taking advantage of young musicians who think that they'll make it if they do what they say and take part in that shit. And it's really cool. Very catchy song. Number three, The Sweetest Song. Like, especially like the verses are so cool with the just like killer riffs and the way Ginger sings the lyrics there. Really cool. Also like shit ton of riffs in there. And number four, Rooting for the Bad Guy, the album's opener. Because genius lyrics, pretty cool. And also the same thing, like four of my top five songs are actually these progressive rock songs, because it's not all 10-minute songs on that album, but I think those are the best. And number five would be Inner City Overture, because I'm really a sucker for a good ballad, and this one comes close to what a ballad would be like on that heavy album. It's a very cool chord progression. I really appreciate that as a musician, and it's pretty catchy. So yeah, that's my top five.
Right on.
Fuck yeah.
Well, I actually had five honorable mentions too, because I could not on this city like just bring five. There's no fucking way in hell. I mean, not pulling a Jeremy and bringing the whole fucking album was a hard choice, but there's a couple songs I could do with it. I would skip over in the future probably. But number 10 was Unbroken, because that was a damn... I mean, they're all fucking amazing songs. I could take guitar for every one of these songs, because the guitar is fucking incredible on every one of these songs. But number 9 was Borderline, because that song, the lyrics hit me kind of... I know some people like that, but the lyrics hit me. Number 8 was The Sweetest Song, because that was on my list pretty early, but it got pushed down a lot towards the end.
Mm-hmm.
Same with number 7, Rooting for the Bad Guys, which... That should have been in the fucking credits for that movie that just came out, The Bad Guys. That should have been the fucking credits. But number six was Bipolar Baby, because I think we all have known people like that, and that song hits home. Number five was Destroy All Monsters, because I was thinking about how Destroy All Monsters is the, I love how that's the name of all the original Godzilla movies, is Destroy All Monsters. Yeah. This is, yeah. That fucking made me laugh. I've been typing that name a lot in the brackets I've been making. But number four was The Hard Way. Because, I mean, there's no other way to do it, but besides The Hard Way. Number three was Oh Bonita, because that song was touching. That was a very touching song, and it was the guitarists in that song were fucking unbelievably good. Same with number two, Slard Authors. I fucking love the guitarists in that song. I specifically wrote guitar next to that one, because that one just headbanging my ass away just into that song. And I sent the CD to my friend, and I'm like, dude, you got to hear this band. He's like, I never heard of them. I'm like, you got to hear this band. And number one was The Revolution Will Be Televised.
Oh, yeah.
Because that's a fucking banging-ass song. And that's the song where they sound like Offspring. That's the song where I hear them sound like Offspring a little bit with their lyrics. So that's, I thought that's when I kind of came to the conclusion for what I did. But we'll get to that in a bit. Chancy Ponce, what are your top five?
Actually, I had a couple honorable mentions. Number seven for me was Bipolar Baby. Number six was Borderline. Number five was Destroy All Monsters. Nice. Number four was Slaughtered Authors, which I thought was pretty fucking awesome. Number three is Rooting for the Bad Guy. Number two is The Revolution Will Be Televised. And fucking number one for me was The New Flesh. I don't know what it was that about The New Flesh that really like just grabbed a hold of me, but it was like, fucking A, man, this thing is fucking badass.
Nice.
The Hard Flesh was good, but I wasn't like gonna make my list. It just wasn't gonna make my list. I mean, it was good, but like I said, I could have brought the whole album really, but I was in a mood where I wanted to be a little picky, not really picky, because I still brought five honorable mentions. So obviously I'm not being too picky, but it just, I don't know, that's just the way I did it. I had to go with it that way. But
oh, Chancy, did you also watch the live in the studio version where they're playing all the songs in the studio?
I got to watch part of it. Yeah, I was trying to watch it while I was in between calls and fucking work and shit. But fucking man, I'm gonna take some time to watch the whole thing from start to finish. That shit was good.
Yeah, and it's really impressive how close to the studio recording.
How close? Yep.
They sound. Yeah.
I absolutely fucking love that shit.
Songs are really hard to play. Trust me.
For sure. Oh yeah, just watching, just listening to it, like just having a little bit of knowledge as a player, you're like, holy shit, like, how are they fucking, like, what kind of chord progression, like, what kind of finger stretch do they got going on here?
I'm sure they got some good fingering going on there, Chancy, I'm sure, but he would so be saying, fuck you.
What you know about noodling? You don't know nothing about no noodling.
I do, but apparently I gotta cut my nails today. But
noodling and chicken picking.
Oh, I know me some chicken picking. No one do get you wrong there. But there's some in the front yard. You want to go pick them for me? But
not real chickens, sir.
I know. I'm being a dick. I'm allowed to be. But all right, I guess it's time to progress to my album, which, as I said, I picked because of The Revolution Will Be Televised, and I heard that, and I'm like, all right. Chancy brought this artist once, and I have to redeem this fucking artist because of how Chancy brought it, bringing their newest album, and it sucked fucking balls. So I decided to bring one of the last good albums they did, The Offsprings Rise and Fall, Rage and Grace, which is a incredible fucking...
Show me how to lie, you're getting better all the time, and turning all against one is an art that's hard to teach. Another clever word sets off an unsuspecting hurt, and as you step back in the line, a mob jumps to their feet. Now dance, fucker, dance, man, he never had a chance, and I won't even
it brings me back to 90s Offspring. It really does. And as an Offspring fan since I was a kid, Rise and Fall, Rage and Grace, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, is the album that got me back into Offspring in my 20s. Because it's like, I got out of them for a while and I heard one of these songs on the radio or something, or I heard it somewhere, movie maybe, I don't fucking remember, but, and I'm like, I started checking out this album, and I'm like, you know what, this album's actually fucking amazing. Like, there's not every song on it am I gonna love, but the songs I do love, I fucking love. So I had to bring the CD because it's what they remind me of. I didn't want to bring Metallica because we just did Metallica a couple episodes ago, and Metallica for me is, I gotta be in a mood to listen, to really enjoy Metallica, and I haven't been in that mood lately. So it's, Metallica's like the burn the world mood, you know. But
really, you're gonna dude, you equate Metallica's music to burn the fucking world? I mean, I don't know.
If we're talking about the first four albums, maybe, yeah.
I mean, I would say the first four albums are solid kindling for starting the world on fire. But I mean, we're talking like, I'm thinking like Napalm Death or Death or Cannibal Corpse or fucking, you know, Hammer Smashed Face.
They don't have the guitar riffs that Metallica has, dude. I mean, and I'm thinking Death Magnetic. That's my.
You're thinking Death Magnetic? Are you fucking kidding me? Get the fuck out of here! Get the fuck out of here,
dude. When you're pissed off at somebody, you put on Cyanide. Oh my god, it's a whole different experience,
dude. When you're pissed, dude. Honestly, listening to you say that makes me want to fucking eat some Cyanide. That's some fucking now the diesel engine's warmed up. I'm ready to go. Like, that's fucking ridiculous. You're like, oh man, Metallica's this burn the world down type of album, but Death Magnetic was the shit. Man, that's like saying their garage album was their best album they ever did. Oh, quick secret, by the way, all of them are fucking covers. They didn't even come up with one of them. None of them.
Yeah, but they're great covers, though, I think.
They are good covers. I'll give you that, yeah. Fry. I'll give you that. But they didn't even have the originality to set the world on fire with their own shit on anything other than the first four albums, which is all fucking Dave Mustaine, because that was all his guitar, and they fucking stole it. Dirty fucking bastards. I'm sorry.
Don't underestimate Cliff Burton's influence.
Oh, dude, Cliff Burton was the fucking genius of the band, for sure.
Yeah.
I can only imagine how awesome it would have been if Cliff would have survived and fucking and Dave would have been able to keep his shit under control. They could have been like the greatest metal band of all time. Like, I mean, easy.
Megadeth rule. So I think I'm very happy for Dave that he actually got
out of the
band, because Megadeth, they're so fucking awesome. They can do whatever they want.
Yeah, you're not wrong.
They
can. I mean, I think Metallica did pretty fine on their own, dude. They did pretty fine. They're an internationally known band at this point, and they're freaking loved. So
you're right. They are the only band that's performed on every continent, but they performed on every continent based upon the shoulders of Cliff Burton and the sweat of Dave Mustaine. They literally got their fame from their first four albums, which all the riffs, as far as guitar riffs on those four albums, or Dave fucking Mustaine. I mean, we can go around the circle. We can go around and around the garden all we want.
Yeah, but actually, we're actually talking about the Offspring, right?
Yeah. Sorry, Fry. Sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
I'm going to take a shit in your garden, okay?
You fucking, I don't even have a garden. You're shitting in somebody's garden, but it ain't mine.
I can't hear what you're saying because my headphones decided to fucking die at this point. But...
Yeah. Right. So yeah.
At least you didn't hear what I had to say about his fucking mother.
Hey.
I know, it was a joke.
Dolores Mantooth is a respectable woman.
Dorothy Mantooth is a saint.
Yeah, okay. It's been a while since I've seen that movie. But yes, we were talking about Offspring, and Fry, what did you think of Rise and Fall, Rage and Grace?
All right, first of all, don't get me wrong, I had to skip the first three songs.
Really?
You know why? Because they all feature the same fucking lame chord progression that's been featured in like every major pop song for the past 25 years. And I don't care if it's punk or supposed to be punk. If you're using that chord progression, I will skip the fucking song. I mean, there are great exceptions to this rule, but all of these exceptions were written when this wasn't a thing, like Let It Be,
yeah,
or Iggy Pop's The Passenger. Those are great songs because they were written back when that wasn't a cliche yet. And ever since like the late 90s, like Zombie by the Cranberries features the same chord progression. And I can't listen to this anymore. So first song, when I heard Half Truism, I thought, okay, I mean, they got Self-Esteem and The Kids Are All Right. Also, same chord progression. They had some big hits with those chords. But come on, you don't have to repeat this, even though you're a punk band. So I skipped the first song. Then the same fucking chord progression in the second song, Trust in You. I skipped that. Then the same fucking chord progression in the third song. And then Hammerhead came along and I was thinking, okay, interesting structure, actual riffs. But then in the chorus, it's the same chord progression again, minus one chord, where they just changed the last chord. So that's just a small minus because the rest of the song is cool. Okay, so first three songs were out of the window right away. But I have to say, like, A Lot Like Me is a killer song. Takes Me Nowhere is pretty catchy, but it's not the right order. I give you my top five now. First, my favorite song is
The OC Life. Let Chancy give his review first. I want to hear Chancy's review first and hear his rant.
Oh, I honestly, like, you know, Fry hit it pretty much on the head. Like, you're talking about how you brought this to redeem my, like, listen, I will admit that I brought the most recent Offspring album and it was fucking hot garbage, but I made that choice based on one song, and it's one of their songs that I've always liked from their first fucking album. I think is the first album, Ixnay of the Hombre, when they were good. But like, everything he said about the chord progression was totally fucking solid. While he was going on that monologue, I was literally out foraging for fucking firewood so we could keep this roast going, like, for fucking real. Burn the witch. Like, don't get me wrong, like, you know, Offspring's good and shit, the old stuff, but like, when you're like, oh, I gotta redeem you for this, I literally thought you were gonna bring Ixnay, and I was like, oh, that's solid, because, you know, yeah, I would totally fucking redeem for anything else that Bob beforehand. No, you brought this fucking shit. There was a whole lot of fall. There's a whole lot of fall and a whole lot of rage. There's a bunch of skin knees and pissed off drunk dads. That's all I know. But like, for real though, like, I didn't even think about the chord progression until Fry mentioned it. And I was listening in my head. I'm like, holy fuck, he's right. Like, it is exact cookie cutter. We're going to use this for this one. Repeat. We're not going to do the rinse and repeat the third time. We're going to take this one out, make it look like we changed something. But, I mean, I still came up with a top five because, you know, I got to come up with a top five for something.
I mean, you also got to remember, the people that listen to Offspring still nowadays are the same people who were listening to it in the 90s, but now they're just drunk stoner dads, and they just they're going to try on the new Offspring CD and be like, it's like being a kid again, man.
And I question their fucking faculties, because for real though, like, fucking, yeah, it's the same guys that were listening back when they were, you know, cool, which I would technically qualify as one of those guys, but even still, I would have to say, no, dude, this shit sucks. Fucking.
Hey, pretty fly for a white guy was my dad's.
Pretty, dude. Yeah. Pretty fly for a white guy is exactly the example that I was hoping you would bring up to prove my entire fucking point. Like, holy fucking hot garbage wrapped around MTV fucking packaged, glorified fucking, what was the name? slaughtered authors, dude. It's more like slaughtered artists. There are so many fucking other artists that deserve that shot other than give it to me, baby. Fucking get the fuck out of here with that shit. And all the girlies say, I'm pretty fly for a white guy. Nowadays, they'd have been like, on all the girlies say mean things. That's why I'm packing heat and going to school, all right? Fucking Jesus Christ. That kid was a fucking incel. Everybody made fun of him. And fucking ain't nobody giving no pussy to that little fucking punk-ass kid. Rant over.
I swear to God, if you guys cancel for that, I swear to fucking God.
What? Why? I didn't say that I'm doing anything. I'm just saying the character in a fictionalized music fucking video said or did something. Man, fucking take me to court. I'll be like Larry Flint. I'll go straight to the Supreme Court. I'll be like, fuck you guys. I said a comment, which is my First Amendment right, about a fictionalized everything, which has nothing to do with any kind of bearing of all these purse-clutching bitches in the fucking Midwest and the Bible Belt. Fucking... get your god. What happened to your fucking Massachusetts balls there, Jeremy? Fucking A, bro. You guys are supposed to be the forefront on go fuck yourself. You fucking letting me down.
Dude, if there's one thing I can tell you, it's the Massachusetts government's a fucking shit show. But
I know. Oh, trust me, I know the Massachusetts government's a shit show, but the Massachusetts people have always been my heroes with like New Yorkers and people from New Jersey, because they were always the first ones to go tell you to go fuck yourself and have a nice day. But no, for real though, Fry, what is your top five for this fucking oh wait, no, Jeremy's gotta give his top five first. I'm sorry. I almost skipped him on that.
Yeah, you almost did, you dick. But I fucking...
you know, honestly, I almost think you should sit in timeout and let Fry take your top five just for, A, bringing this piece of shit album and letting your entire state down. You're a terrible state representative, sir. I'm sorry.
Don't make me tell your girl. You call her a bipolar baby.
Oh, dude, I dare you. See what the fuck happens. Because she'll be like, you know what? He probably said that. And he's not too far from right, but at the same time, fuck you for bringing it up.
Well, like I said, not every song on this fucking album is credible, so I only have one honorable mention, which is saying something compared to what I had for the Wildhearts. So the only honorable mention I brought for this is Trust in You, because it's one of the first couple tracks I can skip over them, just like Fry said. But Trust in You is, I like the lyrics in that song to some degree. But because, see, I think Offspring evolved with their music as far as lyric-wise. I think they evolved to, like, adult lyrics instead of, like, the kid lyrics you hear in their original stuff in the 90s. Like, Pretty Fly for a White Guy, they wouldn't do that nowadays. There's no way in hell they would do that.
But that's not their original stuff, man. That was already, it's like, not their fourth or fifth album or something.
Yes!
Like, their original stuff is shit like Smash It Up and things like that.
Fucking yeah. Ixnay and the Hombre. I choose fucking Gone Away, like the original Gone Away, not the acoustic version that got put on that piece of shit album I brought. But, like, the original version of Gone Away. Yeah, he's absolutely right. Like, Americana is not original Offspring. It's like fucking...
That's where I got into them. That's where I got into them, because that's the CD that came out in the 99 or 98 when my friends all started listening to it when we were fucking elementary school still.
You had the clickety clackety internety thingies, right? That was a thing in Massachusetts in the 90s, like late 90s.
I didn't live in Massachusetts in the 90s, and back then it was AOL with that like
we had the screaming man from dial up, but at the same time, like, here, over here, even in Iowa, like, I would find an artist, and then I would search out whatever the fuck I could find, regardless of the album. So, I was always trying to find, you know, like...
I didn't find my own music till like, high school. Like, I was listening to what... Like, I was either picking up CDs at FYE randomly, or I was listening whatever was on the radio, or whatever the hell my older cousin that was, like, 5 years old that would be listening to. Like,
That's actually kind of how it started. Like, I would pick up an album from the record store, and then I would be like, oh, man. And then I would use the album, like, you know, the title for the artist and shit like that, to look up online to see what other stuff they had.
I, I didn't know what the fucking internet could do when I was that age, dude. I didn't know what it could do. Like, I mean, yeah, I found Playboy.com like a year in, but still, like, and after that, like, you know where I was during the internet every time I fucking went on it. But, my number five was Let's Hear It for Rock Bottom, because once again, mm-hmm. that's a song adults can relate to. And I'm not gonna lie, I like their guitar. I don't care if it's the same chord over and over again. That chord works for them. I'm gonna fucking go with it. Like, it does work for them.
Yeah, but that's not one of those songs, though.
I know it's
also in, it's also in my top five. It's a good song.
Well,
good song.
And number four for me is Stuff Is Messed Up, because I love like in the middle of the course of that, when like they start doing like the really fast singing that they're known for, like that shit always like gets me going with them. Like, I love when they do that. That actually, I meant to bring, well, after I listened to the CD, I'm like, where's the song I'm thinking of? And I'm like, oh, that must be on the CD before or after this. I can't think of what it is. Like, but Johnny Rides the Rocket to Hell, or whatever the hell it's called. I think it's on the CD after this, but
Jeremy Rides the Short Bus to School, I think was the name of the track.
Fuck you, Chancy. Fuck you. And number three was You're Gonna Go Far, Kid. Because that reminds me
is.
That reminds me of Americana. That reminds me of Americana. Like, that's an Americana style song.
Yeah, because it has the same chord progression.
I love how he's just roasting the shit out of you on the technical element, and I'm just filling it in like, nah, dude, you do the technical shit. I got the rest of it. We got this.
Yeah, you're playing the triangle there, Chancy. But number two is Takes Me Nowhere.
Yeah,
that's a fucking solid song lyric wise and guitar wise. But
right, yeah, that's also my number two.
And then number one of course is Hammerhead, because it I love how it makes fun of the American South, basically. They should have done a video for that. That was handmade. I could fucking make that video and make it amazing. But I've pictured it many times in my head while listening to the song. But Hammerhead is an amazing fucking song, and I don't know, just the way they sing in that song, and then the way at the end they get all excited, like, it's just, I love that shit with them. Like, it brings me back to my childhood. Offspring brings me back to my childhood. Brings me back to fucking late 2000s when I was fucking like in college and listening to this shit, like while like drinking and shit. Like, Hammerhead's a good drinking song. It really fucking is. Like, you'll mosh out in your fucking dorm room to that shit while you're drinking. But it doesn't matter if there's anybody else there. You'll be moshing into fucking cabinets and shit, but you'll do it. But yes, Fry, what are your top five for Offspring?
Right. Honorable mention would be Hammerhead. Yeah, because like it's got an interesting structure. It was the first song I didn't skip. it's got actual riffs, and it's pretty solid. But my number five would be the song after that, A Lot Like Me, because it sounds different from the first four songs, and it makes the album sound a little more versatile.
I didn't want to put that one on my list, but that is that's one of the more adult songs now, because I think what they wrote about is like a kid, like about having a kid and like being told the kid's not your, like the kid doesn't think he's yours, but like you look a lot like me. So yeah, I mean, metaphorically or physically, either way you can go with that. But
yeah, number four, Rock Bottom, because the lyrics are cool, like those, and the guitar parts are also pretty solid. Then number three, Rise and Fall. It's got a great structure and great guitars. Number two, Takes Me Nowhere, because it's really catchy. And the best song, I think, is the OC Life, because that song actually sounds like early Offspring.
Oh,
like cool chord progression. Cool chord progressions, like a little more aggressive. That reminded me of stuff from Smash.
Oh, see, Spotify doesn't have OC Life on this album. I forgot this was on this album. I had this on Apple. That was an Apple exclusive track, I think. So
now listen to it on YouTube.
Yeah, dude, it's on YouTube.
Yeah.
I forgot about OC Life. Fuck. I love that song. I forgot that song was on the CD even. Like, I didn't have it. What the fuck?
Yeah, I think it's the best song.
I mean, it's
It is actually, yeah. And it, that's it, also That's also reason 787,446 as to why fucking you should probably listen to YouTube rather than Spotify.
Yeah. I don't like Spotify for music.
Spotify works 95% of the time, but fucking OC Life, I forgot about that shit. That is like their old, that was a bonus.
Solid.
That's the bonus track because it was like their old shit, but.
And like when I heard that song, I was thinking like, why are they playing it safe? I mean, they put that song on there. I mean, it's last on the version that I heard, but I think that's what a lot of their original fans would want to hear.
And actually, I had the physical CD for this back in the day when it came out because I didn't really have Apple or anything back then even. So I had the original CD for this, and that's where it was. It was on the original CD as a bonus track.
Yeah.
But Chancy, what are your top five?
Well, I did actually have a honorable mention.
Oh, did you now, Mr. Shitaka? Did you now?
Oh, I totally absolutely talked all of the shit. Number six for me was Christy, Are You Doing Okay?
That song's okay, but to me it's just like, eh.
That's why it's at the end of the list. Number five was OC Life. Number four was A Lot Like Me. Let's see. Number three was Let's Hear It for Rock Bottom. Mm-hmm. Number two was Hammerhead. And number one was Fix You.
Yeah, Fix You is a good song. It's just...
it hit me on a different sort of level, though. Yeah. I had a lot more resonance with that element of the song play rather than anything else.
Yeah, I mean, Fix You is a good song. It really is.
Because it's not fucking Ixnay and the Hombre where everything's a fucking ass-kicking tune, like you're getting ready to throw on your fucking blades and roll down the street, you know?
I mean, yeah, like I said, a lot of the songs in this one are a lot more like grown-up adult like songs, because they're in their, what, 40s now, 50s now, probably?
Well, actually, that depends, because they basically got rid of fucking every other member of the band except for the lead singer.
Well, he's got to be in his 40s or 50s, so...
he's the only original member. Like, the bass player is the second most original member, and then they just got rid of their drummer because he wouldn't get the corona shot, like, because he's literally allergic to it. So it's like, oh, fuck you.
That is so fuck punk, you, man. That is so punk.
I know, right? So punk. Like, get your vaccine regardless of anaphylactic shock. You know what? Yeah. Fuck you and your personal health. We fucking want to do stuff and make money. Oh yeah. Wait, that's not punk rock. I forgot. That's my bad, guys.
Yeah. That's weird, man.
It's strange. I haven't heard that, but I mean, I believe it 100%. It's definitely would. I could see them doing that, but I don't know. This album was a college favorite for me. So, but like I said, there's a lot of songs in this that I can easily skip over if I'm hearing them too often. But Chancy, what album did you bring? And I'm happy we saved this one for last just because of who our guest is, but what album did you bring?
You know, a little while back, I think it's about a month or so back, maybe a little bit longer. I got this message on my messenger and I was like really surprised. I was like, wow, that's awesome. I can't believe he actually remembered to think about me. And he's like, hey, dude, I got this EP coming out. And I was like, fucking, we're absolutely having it on. I don't care if we have to move heaven and earth. We're doing this fucking thing. And then he sent me the tracks and I was like, I'm so glad that I said that before I even listened to it, because I was so much more excited about having this album on after having listened to the tracks. Dude, I brought our great guest, Phry McDunstan's album. Well, it's an EP, but it's an album. I don't give a fuck. It's called Choice. It's fucking choice.
And once the wheels come off and everything you always used to take for granted goes away, what we've got is precious, though it's not for us to keep forever and a day. The broken bones, broken hearts, or broken spirits have been fixed against despair.
Like USDA top choice fucking kick ass is exactly what it is. Like fucking, I can't even think of a song on this thing that I didn't even like. Like fucking A, man. I know there's only a few of them to choose from, but that's not even saying nothing. Like literally, I'm surprised you were able to get six with the amount of fucking awesome that you condensed into that EP.
Oh boy. Thank you so much, man. That's really flattering, and I'm really grateful that you picked the EP. It's so cool that you enjoy the song so much, and wow.
And that's out now, right? Like you can get that now, right?
Yesterday,
right? Yeah.
Fuck yeah! You better get the fuck out there and buy that shit for your favorite fucking musician for Christmas, because that shit is fucking what's up.
Yeah, it is. But, yeah, and All right, we're going to skip our guest review on this album because I'm pretty sure I'm pretty sure he knows how he's going to talk about this album. But I listened to this yesterday on my way home from work, and I fucking enjoyed the shit out of this. Like, it had a very 80s feel to it. It had like an 80s hair metal feel to it almost, which I mean, from now Europe, I expect that nowadays, but I fucking love that. Like, I love that. That's the way a lot of it sounded. I'm not going to lie, I somehow didn't download The Long Walk, so I missed that one. Because I'm like, didn't Chancy say there are 6 songs in this? And then, like, I got to one that, like, something on my phone that was called Radio. And I'm like, is this a 6 song? And I'm like, no, that's an ad I made for somebody else's show. And I'm like, what the fuck? And I'm like, okay, I must have missed one. And I just looked at it again. I'm like, oh, I missed The Long Walk. Okay, I'll have to definitely listen to that one later today. But I enjoyed the fuck out of the 5 tracks I heard. I definitely could put them in order of 5. And there was one track that was just like, but the rest of them were fucking incredible. Like, I'm pretty sure you can almost guess what that one track is, but you'll find out eventually anyway. But I enjoyed the shit out of it. The guitar on it is, of course, incredible on all of it. And the fucking lyrics and the singing on most of them is freaking incredible as well. So, as soon as Chancy said, hey, guess who just hit me up? And I'm like, Jesus, I don't know. He's like, Phry McDunstan. I'm like, no shit. I'm like, why is he hitting you up? he's like, you got an EP coming out. I'm like, he's like, can we get back on the show? I'm like, of course we fucking can. Of course we can. It's fucking Phry. He was one of our first actual musicians that came on as a guest. Of course he can come back on the show. Why wouldn't I bring him back on? I enjoyed this EP immensely, and I was happy Chancy brought it, because, I mean, we would have listened to it regardless, because it's only 6 songs, and I would have listened to it regardless so we could talk about it on the show, but when Chancy said he wanted to bring it, I'm like, all right, Chancy's getting hard for this shit, so it must be good.
I mean, I wasn't gonna not bring the damn thing. I mean, it's fucking like you said, it's fucking awesome. And like, also fucking shit, man. Like you said, Phry's one of the first like solid musicians that we've had on the show. And to hear that there was something else like coming down the line, like, I was fucking super excited. Dude, when you first like got a hold of me and sent me that clip of just the single, I was fucking sold. Like, I was like, done. I don't care. The rest of it could be fucking, screaming cats for all I care, and I'd have been happy with it.
Well, I mean, yeah, and basically, we mean no offense to our other guests who have been on that you're not real musicians, just saying, putting that out there. But Chancy's trying to get people fucking pissed at us and have riots and pitchforks in front of my house. But
I mean, honestly, I would debate them because of the fact that the statement I made was one of the first. So unless they fall into the category of pre-Phry, then they have no valid argument to my fucking statement. And if they get all butthurt and detract fucking what I said as a negative thing, then they're fucking stupid, like straight fucking hard R retarded, because I said one of the first. If you were the first, then cool beans. Anybody after the fact, you are post fucking Phry. So take your place in line, eat your fucking cookie, juice is on the way, shut the fuck up.
See, someday when our podcast is down in the history books, like 500 years from now, well, this is the period that the one with gray in his hair called the post-Phry period. That's what it's going to be. But yeah, and well, Chancy, you brought it. So what are your 6 in order?
So for me, honestly, it's all unilateral except for number 1. All the other 5 albums or the other 5 tracks on the album could have probably been... That's actually not true either. I'll just read it. So number 6 for me is Siren. Number 5 is Work With What We Got. Number 4 is The Long Walk. Those 3 could have been in any of those 3 options. Solid. Hardcore solid. Number 3, Funk Fest. Definitely. Number two was Who's Killing Who? And number one is absolutely, it's the single. It's called Choice. Fucking, it is a goddamn banger. And to be bluntly honest, dude, 4, 5, and 6 could have been interchangeable. Just about as much as two or three could have been interchangeable. But Choice was definitely the number one pick, like, right out the gate. Just because of, like, all the technical fucking guitar work, including both on Who's Killing Who and Funkfest. Dude, it's fucking, like, I can't explain it. You gotta buy it so you can hear it, so that way you can get what the fuck I'm talking about. It's fucking, it's kind of like what you'd wish shit would happen in music today, just, like, you know, actually happening.
Exactly. Which, Fry, do you have a top 6 for your own album in the order you prefer, or do you prefer not to even try and number your own creation?
I mean, I can also say that Choice is also my favorite song. I don't know, when I've been carrying this riff around for, like, years. It actually came out of a finger exercise I invented to teach to my students, so they could play the pentatonic in a more musical way. And I always wanted to write something with that. And yeah, for this EP, I finally did. And I mean, the fact that I got to meet Jeff Bragg on Fiverr, and that he wanted to work with me, or that I was able to hire him, makes like, I still write the lyrics and vocal melodies and sing them to him when I send him the demos, and record demos with me singing. And if you would hear, like, my version and his versions, you would understand why I'm really excited to work with him, and why I always revisit or, like, rehire him for each new release. And as, like, his contribution, and also Glenn's, the drummer's contribution, really make me also enjoy, like, I don't want to say my own music, but enjoy
making the music.
Yeah, making the music, because they elevate my ideas to another level. So this is why Choice is also, like, my favorite song, because of his singing and the drumming there, because they're really great. And also, like, Who's Killing Who, because the guy who's singing on that one is my main man, Jesse, who mixed the EP for free because he's a fan of my music. And I'm actually doing a live stream with him after this podcast here. And this is the first song I released where the singer wrote his own lyrics and vocal melodies, and he did a fantastic job. And I'm also really grateful for having met him. So yeah, that would be my two favorite songs.
Yeah, hey. Well, like I said, I didn't get a chance to listen to The Long Walk, but I will gladly push my number 5 down to number 6, because my number 6 technically now was Funk Planet, just because that's just the one that I was just like, eh. Like, I liked it, but I, like, it's not a song I'm going to go back to again and again. Like, most of your songs play on my, songs on Spotify, like, pretty occasionally. But whenever they get back to the random rotation brings it around to those. But, I mean, Time After Time plays all the freaking time. So, or is that what that's
Time and Time Again.
Time again.
Yeah. Man, you are just fucking 0-0 on this fucking naming the tracks, honest. You're just really shooting the
fucking the song is actually here. Called Funk Fest, not Funk.
Yeah. Planet. Yeah, Funk Planet. For fuck's sake.
Fucking autocorrect. But
for funk's sake.
For funk's sake. I love it. Hey, that was a good one.
Funk Planet would have been a fucking awesome name too. But
Planet, yeah. Planet Funk. Planet Funk. Funk. Yeah. Well, but
that's some James Brown shit. But
get down.
So I'll put Long Walk number 5, just because does it have anything to do with the Stephen King book by chance?
Yes, it does. And I'm glad you got it. Wow, yeah, it's inspired by that book.
I definitely don't listen to it then, because I read that book, and that's a fucking good book. But
yeah, it's killer.
But my number four was Work With What We Got, because that was like a classic 80s like ballad type song, and I fucking loved it. Like, it was just it reminded me of so many other bands, and like the way they sing things, and just the lyrics were amazing. Number three was Siren, because that was a fucking dope ass song. Number two was, of course, Who's Killing Who, because that the guy your boy was saying that, Jesse. I love his voice. I love the lyrics in it. And number one, of course, was Choice, because that is a banger fucking track. Like, I could listen to that every fucking day. And as soon as this album's on fucking Spotify, which it might be now, I don't know. But as soon as
it's on Spotify, it's on there.
When I realized it came out December 8th, I was like I realized that last night, and I was making up the fucking ad for the show, and I'm like, wonder if I actually could listen to it on Spotify, Tay, then I wouldn't have missed the fucking song. But Choice was a fucking amazing track, and the guitar work and all of these is fucking incredible, as I said. So, I mean, this took up like 2/3 of my way home from work yesterday, and I enjoyed the fuck out of it. And then I had to put on some fucking Christmas music for another show I'm doing today, but I enjoyed the shit out of it, so... Well done, sir. Well done. You never cease to disappoint me with your music. So,
No. You fucking, good God, you make us look so bad. You never cease to amaze me with your music. When you say that you never cease to disappoint me, you're literally saying that he always fucking disappoints you when he puts something out, man.
Dude,
for fuck's sake.
Dude, I have English. I haven't had my herbal medicine yet today, okay? Give me a fucking break.
No breaks given. Santa Claus gives no breaks.
Just because you got gray in your hair, motherfucker. But, oh, I did. But I fucking shaved all that off, so I wouldn't have gray in my hair anymore. But, because it was depressing me on a daily basis. But, and if I had the amazing gray hair you have, that might be a different story. But mine was just kind of, I look like fucking Reed Richards with my fucking little gray here and there between my black hair. But,
like on the sides?
Yeah, dude, that'd have been cool as fuck.
That's awesome, man. Yeah.
If it actually came in fully like that, then yes, I would have kept it. But it came in little strands on the sides, and like it looked like Reed Richards in his fucking 20s.
Maybe. Yeah.
I mean, it makes sense.
You should have talked to Marvel. I mean, they've been casting the new Fantastic Four.
I am not going to be fucking Pedro Pascal after that. I'm not going to be Pedro Pascal after that. No fucking way.
I mean, he's not the perfect choice for that role, and
I agree.
It would have been really hard to beat him in an audition.
I think the perfect choice has already been fucking done in two movies, and they should have kept him. But you know, they don't listen.
He's like Reed Richards if you ordered him off of Temu or Wish.
Oh, don't tell Shanna that. She's fucking already plastering her couch and getting it ready for when that movie comes out.
I was talking about you, not Pedro.
Why didn't they go with John Krasinski, because they already had him in that Doctor Strange movie?
I thought that was kind of weird. He did a great job.
Because that's not the universe the movie takes place in. The movie takes place in the universe of the rest of the Marvel movies, so they can't do that.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, they can recast like everyone basically, which is why that whole multiverse thing sucks and has ruined their that's a part of why they ruined their franchise with it.
It didn't ruin the franchise, because they could have some dream casting that never got done in alternate universes and for like a scene.
It soon turned into a gimmick, and there'll be no more stakes if you can just revive everyone or bring them back in some other form all the time. You know.
But I mean, like, I don't know. I mean, I would love to see Robert Downey Jr. come back as Iron Man as he was dressed in Tropic Thunder.
Yeah, he could play Rhodey.
That's good. That's funny.
I'm the dude playing the other dude who's Tony Stark. But, well, folks, we brought you three amazing albums. Shut up, Chancy. And we brought you an amazing EP by our guests, which you will be hearing tracks from that in the opening and the closing of this episode if you're listening to it in audio form. So, you're welcome. And, of course, Phry, where can they find your music and where can they find you if they want to hear the rest of the amazing things you've done if they didn't listen to the last episode because you were dicks? Huh.
All right. First of all, thanks again for having me, and thanks again for picking my EP and your feedback. It's so flattering, and I'm really happy you enjoyed it. Okay, you can find me. You can stream my music on every major digital streaming platform because DistroKid takes care of that. It puts it out on all of those DSPs. You can stream it on YouTube, watch the music videos there. It's at Phry McDunstan. You can visit my website, music.phrymcdunstan.com. And yeah, go listen to the EP. Damn. And maybe join my community. That would be cool. Like wherever you find my music, especially on YouTube, there's links to my community. I would be happy to welcome you there and get to know you better.
There you go.
Yeah.
Get a chance to hang out with a fucking badass guitarist. There you go.
A badass musician, sir. Musician. He's more than just a guitar player.
Hey. I advertised it as German rock star, so I took care of it. But he's the next fucking, I can't even think of a German band at this point. But
don't bring up the Scorpions, please, because they suck.
I was gonna say he could. I mean, there's a, like, you know, I don't know. You I mean, if you want to just get really like top of your head, quick thinker, you could go Rammstein.
Yeah,
sure thing. They're great. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, fuck.
I was trying to think if Avantasia is actually from Germany or they're from England. I couldn't remember. But
or like that other band that we listened to last time. What were they?
Powerwolf.
Powerwolf. Yeah.
Yeah.
Powerwolf.
I mean, dude, I am telling you, if you could do a song and let Attila sing the fucking lyrics, I would freaking be amazingly happy with that. But Chancy, where can they find you?
You know, Ninth Circle of Hell, Darkness of the Void. You know, the most uneventful scavenger hunt on Facebook continues. This is my actual name. If you can find me, good fucking luck. Instagram, TikTok, it's the Red Eye Roundtable. And on X, it is Red Eye Table. And of course, naturally, you can find me on the bottom part of the screen making fun of him for the most part.
You're making fun of God? How dare you?
I mean, you know, I can make fun of myself all I want. That's kind of how it rolls.
You can find both your fucking musers. If you want to find the guy above me, I don't fucking know. That's your choice, but you can find both your musers on YouTube as Uncensored, Unapologetic, and Untamed UQ Podcast Collective Group. You could also find us on XX Baby in the Gram as that Juggalo Bastard. You could find us on Tiki Talkie as that Juggalo Bastard Podcast. And you can find us on YouTube as Maniacal Music Musings. Or you could find us streaming live on Blind Knowledge Network, because all knowledge was blind. Until Chancy admits he's not fucking God. Come on now. Fuck. We're going to go back in darkness for that. Shit, dude. You're fucking us all. But your musers are out, and we will be back on Tuesday with a stand-up comedian as our guest. So, Mr. Glenn Tickle will be joining us. And I love that fucking name. I just do. But we will see you Tuesday. And once again, we want to thank Phry for coming on, because it's always fun to have him on. And we'll see him the next time he releases an EP as well, probably. So,
awesome. Shit, he doesn't have to release an EP to come back. He can come back any fucking time, man.
True.
Oh, man, that's so cool. I will. Next year, there's going to be another one. And yeah, I'd be honored to come back.
Well, just like
Fuck
Santa.
Yeah.
Just like Santa, Phry comes once a year. So he'll be back. And musers are going to be heading out. Peace.
Just kind of
Dexter Holland, and I approve this message.